Whether it's relationships or YouTube videos, effective communication is key. Even our nervous system requires communication to work. So today on Brief Brain Facts, let's look at how our brain communicates. But before I do, make sure to subscribe to this channel if you want to learn more about that thing in your head. No, not those thoughts about what you should have said during that argument, but the brain. Our brain consists of two cell types. The majority of those cells are glial cells, which occasionally transmit information to other cells in the brain, but are primarily responsible for insulating and nourishing our second cell type, neurons. Neurons are the communicator cells, while glial cells are the supporting cells. Turning our attention to the neuron, located at the top are little branches called dendrites. These dendrites act like antennas. They allow the neuron to receive information from other cells. The neuron also includes a soma, or cell body. The cell body is very dense and a dark shade of gray, so much so that it is visible to the naked eye, accounting for the brain tissue commonly called gray matter. Protruding from the cell body is a long stem called the axon. Axons needed for quick communication are coated with myelin sheaths. This coating allows for the signal to skip across the sheaths, landing in the tiny gaps of exposed axon called nodes of Ranvier. They are white and also visible to the naked eye, accounting for the brain tissue that's commonly referred to as white matter. You can consider axons as major roadways. They essentially connect our cells together. At the end of these roadways are tiny offshoots called axon terminals. These terminals connect with dendrites of other cells. A good analogy is to think of the dendrites, axon, and axon terminals as part of a tree. The dendrites are the branches, the axon is the tree trunk, and the axon terminals are the tree roots. Between the axon terminals and the dendrites of neighboring neurons is a small gap known as the synaptic cleft. Now you know the structure of a neuron, but what happens when you get them talking in a room together? Neurons need to be stimulated enough to fire electrical impulses, such as when one neuron has a juicy rumor to tell to a neighboring neuron. You know, stimulating conversation. The information in the form of an electrical signal travels from the dendrites to the soma. Under the right conditions, the decision to transfer the message, or fire the neuron, is made. It's these conditions that determine if our chatty neuron spreads a rumor to its neighbor or not. Our neurons communicate via the power of electricity and chemicals. Well, not exactly. It's electrical, then chemical, then electrical again, just for the sake of confusion. But let's start at the first place, electricity. So, quick fact, our bodies handle electricity like a battery. In it, there are equal amounts of positive and negative charged atoms called ions, but some areas consist of higher concentration of positive ions, while other areas consist of higher concentration of negative ions. Due to the fact that opposite ions are attracted to each other, like two quarreling children, they need to be separated, and this is done with the help of a membrane. When cells with excitable membranes aren't generating impulses, i.e., they're not firing, they're at rest. Thus, they're simply waiting for those details from chatty neuron about how neuron Skylar is cheating on neuron River. Shame on you, Skylar. The resting state of a neuron is called the resting membrane potential, and it depends on the concentration of positively and negatively charged ions on both sides of the cell membrane, and this concentration is measured in millivolts. The resting membrane potential of any given neuron is about negative 70 millivolts. Thus, a neuron that's just chilling is more negatively charged on the inside of the cell relative to the outside of the cell. However, there's a constant fight over the neuron's polarity, because just like many people, the ions on both sides of the cell membrane desire balance. And also just like many people, they can never seem to achieve that balance. Ions play an important role in cellular communication, and the main ions at work here are sodium, potassium, calcium, and chloride. To better understand neuronal communication, let's turn our attention to sodium and potassium. Surrounding a chillin' like a villain neuron are high concentrations of sodium ions, while inside the neuron exists potassium ions. While both ions are positively charged, inside the cell, potassium ions are surrounded by negatively charged protein molecules. Additionally, there are more sodium ions surrounding the outside of the cell compared with the amount of potassium ions contained within the cell. This cellular makeup results in a cell that's more negatively charged on the inside relative to its outside. These ion concentrations are due to a mechanism called the sodium-potassium pump, a protein embedded within the neuronal membrane that pushes sodium and potassium in and out of the cell. For every 2 ions of potassium pumped into the cell, it pumps 3 sodiums out. Another channel protein called ion channels enables the flow and influences the concentration of ions in and out of the cell. These ion channels behave more like doors. They open and close based on a variety of factors. Most of these channels are voltage gated, meaning they open and then close when the appropriate voltage level for that ion channel is reached. This can be viewed as automatic doors that open in the presence of a specific trigger. Some toxins, which are bad for you, affect these ion channels. For example, tetrodotoxin, a neurotoxin found in pufferfishes, blocks voltage-gated sodium channels, preventing sodium ions from entering the cell. And this can result in a permanent state of deadness. Another ion channel is ligand-gated, or receptor-gated, and they only open or close when the appropriate neurotransmitter latches on to a dedicated receptor site. In this way, ligand-gated channels can be viewed as a closed door with locks, which only open when their fitted key, the appropriate neurotransmitter, fits into the lock, the receptor sites. Just as ion concentrations within and outside of the neuron determine its resting membrane potential, so too do ion concentrations determine when a neuron fires, you know, starts talking. And this is called the action potential. This is a big deal because this is a huge portion of how our nervous system works. The action potential's role is to communicate information. Because ions are electrically charged molecules, electricity influences the way in which they move and concentrate. When an electrical signal triggers the movement of ions, influencing the polarity in and around the cell, gates open, and ions attempt to create balance and quickly diffuse across the membrane. The attempt to create ionic balance is what determines all electrical events that take place in neurons. If channels that aid in the movement of ions fail to open, the amount of sodium rushing into the cell and the amount of potassium rushing out of the cell isn't enough to impact the cell's negative polarization, and the cell will not talk with its neighbors. Thus, the action potential, which is the change of the cell's internal charge from its resting state of negative 70 millivolts to its action state of 40 millivolts, fails to be evoked. This is an all-or-none process, meaning that in order for an action potential to take place, the polarity or charge inside the neuronal membrane relative to its outside must reach 40 millivolts, a process called depolarization. Surpassing this threshold will not affect the size of action potentials, and anything under this threshold means an action potential won't occur. This means that action potentials will always be the same size, but they might be at different speeds. So think of it this way. An action potential triggers when you both step on a tack and step on a pillow, but the tack will definitely cause a higher frequency firing. When the electrical signal strength is strong enough to create an action potential, reversing the polarity inside of the cell as sodium rushes in while potassium rushes out, the electrical signal, our rumor, then runs down the axon to the axon terminal. It is here that was a bit of a quandary. How does the electrical signal get transferred to the next neuron, given that there is a gap between the axon terminals and the neighboring neuron set of dendrites? It is here, at the synaptic cleft, where the electrical message is transformed to a chemical message, as the electrical charge causes the cell to shoot chemicals across the synaptic cleft. This is a major event in cellular communication, because this is where almost all the magic happens. These chemicals are known as neurotransmitters or neuromodulators. When released into the synaptic cleft, neurotransmitters or neuromodulators can affect the ions surrounding the outside of neighboring neurons. The result can be a change in the voltage level of downstream cells. The way in which the voltage changes depends on the chemical that was released and the cell body of the neuron set to receive the information. When excitatory chemicals are released, it can cause the inside of the receiving neuron to become more positive. You know, excitement. But enough excitatory chemicals must be released in order for an action potential to take place. In contrast, if inhibitory chemicals are released into the synaptic cleft, it can result in hyperpolarization of the receiving cell. This is where the inside of the receiving neuron becomes more negative. Usually, both excitatory and inhibitory chemicals are released at the same time, and the creation of the action potential depends on the interplay between the two. While excitation aids in information transmission, inhibition helps process said information. Both excitation and inhibition play a crucial role in the electrical to chemical to electrical transformation of our signal. So let's review. We have two brain cells, neuron and glial. Neurons are the main talkers. To do the talking, they use electrical states and ions to send signals from one end to the other. When something happens, like stepping on a tack, the cells are triggered to talk from where they were at rest to promoting an action. Once they become active, the signal then travels down the neuron and smacks into the end of the cell, sending neurotransmitters flying out of that end and floating towards another cell to get to the next cell to talk, and so on. Neurotransmitters can have both an excitatory or inhibitory effect on the cell. This effect can determine the electrical charge of the next cell, and thus determine the flow of ions, bringing us to start the process all over again to the next cell. If you find yourself edutained, then make sure to subscribe to this channel and share with family and friends. Don't forget to hit that like button. If you want to show your support with big brainiac energy, then head on over to my Patreon page to become a member. And as always, thank you for watching.